Okay, hello chess players. Today we're going to be going over the Ruy Lopez after e4, e5, knight f3, knight c6, bishop to b5 begins the Ruy Lopez, and we're not going to be going over the Berlin defense, which I know is going to be about half of your Ruy Lopez games. Instead, we're going to be going over a6, bishop to a4, knight f6 castles, and we're not going to be going over the marshal, which I know is going to be almost the other half of your Ruy Lopez games. Instead, we're going to be going over a line that they used to play, 10, 20 years ago, this was very popular. We're going to be going over b5, which is called the Columbus variation, and after bishop to b3, we're going to be going over something called the Archangel variation, or the Archangel defense. So anyways, if you like content like this and you want to see more of it, please hit that subscribe button and click on your notification icon. So I'm going to be covering two moves here. I'm going to be covering both bishop to b7 and bishop to c5. Now, these moves actually do have some independent value from each other. They don't both necessarily just transpose into the Archangel. The Archangel typically goes bishop to b7, rook e1, and then bishop c5. So on the surface, you would think that they should just transpose and the move order shouldn't matter. But the move order actually does matter. Playing bishop to c5 first does offer white the opportunity to do something a little bit different and a little bit more aggressively. And I do feel like you should meet this move a little bit more aggressively. And I'm not actually sure what the name of this move is, by the way. If somebody knows, please mention it in the comments. I mean, we're already in the Columbus variation. I don't know what the independent designation of bishop c5 without bishop b7 is, or if it has one. But like I said, I'm just covering it under the same umbrella as the Archangel defense. So after bishop c5, what I really feel like people should be doing is playing c3 and just preparing to strike at this bishop right away. Because you're preparing to strike in the middle, doing everything with tempo. You're going to be playing d4, d5, etc. You're going to be doing all this stuff with tempo, and I think that's really important. Now, another move that you can try here, and I think it's reasonable, and I actually think it's maybe the best move you can play at the club level, is this move knight takes e5. Now, knight takes e5 is just your basic standard fork trick, and anybody that's familiar with the fork trick understands how this works. Is after knight takes e5, they play knight takes e5, and then you play d4, and that forks the bishop and the knight, and it also gains you space in the middle. So after bishop captures, queen captures, you end up with the only central pawn, and that should mean that white has some sort of advantage. After d6, this is the only kind of central pawn left standing. You have the bishop pair. White should have an advantage in the middle of the board. And that would be my thinking as well. But this was actually played. It was played in a Nand versus Toplov in Linares back in 1997. And Nand was not able to do anything better than equality. And the reason for that is if you follow up, even with the computer best line, which is exactly what Anand did, and you play pawn to f4, knight to c6, queen to c3, bishop to b7, and again, e5, this is looking pretty good to me. I would say on the lower levels, this is just going to win 90% of your games right here. But Topalov found the computer best defense, which is knight to e4, queen e3, knight a5, which holds that knight on e4. Anand tries to undermine it, knight to d2. But then a series of exchanges takes place, knight b3, cb3, knight d2, bishop d2, castles, and black has managed to evade all the danger, and with opposite colored bishops and a wide open board, there really isn't anything left to play for. The game continued bishop to c3, queen h4, rook ae1, rook fe8, queen f2, queen f2, rook f2, d takes e5, draw agreed. So Anand wasn't able to get anything out of that, but like I said before, at the club level, I think knight takes e5 is perfectly reasonable. I don't expect most club level players to find all of Topalov's top picks, unless they happen to have this prepared on their engine. So, knight takes e5, reasonable at the club level, and even if they do manage to equalize, you can still, of course, play chess from there as well. But the best move is to play something like pawn to c3 and go after the immediate d4, d5. And I know that a lot of you are thinking, well, if I play pawn to c3, aren't I just hanging this pawn on e4? And yeah, they can take it. They can play knight takes e4. But I wouldn't say you hung it. This is definitely a sacrifice. Like I said, we're threatening to play d4 and d5 both with tempo, and the black king is still in the middle of the board. So white should have a decisive advantage after playing pawn to d4. And this is actually what happened in Nijbor versus Vetter, played in 2003. The game continued e captures d4, c captures d4, bishop e7, d5. Again, everything happening with tempo. Knight a5, bishop c2, hitting that knight on e4, still everything happening with tempo. Knight to d6, and now queen to d3, which threatens queen h7 mate if Black gets his king out of the middle with castle's kingside. So this is worth more than a pawn here. White is down a pawn, but he's not allowing black to get out of the center of the board. So this is a very bad thing for black. As a matter of fact, I think the computer gives this position as +2 for white. It's a very big advantage for white. So here we had this game continue bishop to f6, knight c3, king f8, and then we have a4. This is what happened in the game. The computer preferred rook e1 and just gave major advantage white. But a4 it still gave as major advantage white. Actually, rook e1 it gave us decisive advantage white. a4 it still gives us major advantage white. And the game still ended pretty cleanly, so I'm just going to go ahead and show the rest of the game. It continued a4, b4, knight e4, knight takes e4, queen takes e4, rook b8, rook e1, pawn to b3, bishop d2, knight c6, and then we have this desperado combination. Bishop takes b3, takes on b3, takes on c6. Pawn to d6, and then knight g5, which sets up kind of a cute threat. The idea is to play this incredibly crude knight takes h7, which apparently works. After d5, he ended the game with knight takes h7. Of course, the point being that if rook takes h7, queen h7, we're threatening mate, and we've just won the exchange. So instead we have king to g8, which is forced, knight takes f6, queen takes f6, and then this very cute move, queen to c2, threatening the b3 rook, but also threatening rook e8 mate, because of course the queen covers that h7 escape route. So white effectively wins a rook here, and black resigned. So knight takes e4 is not a move that you're going to want to play. Instead, you're going to want to play something a little bit more sedate as black, something like d6. So this is actually what was played in Kasparov versus Anand, played in Wickenzie in 2001. Continued with d6, and in that game we had a4, and we'll just have to trust that this is correct. This is what Kasparov played. So then we have bishop g4, h3, bishop f3, queen f3, castles, and then a5. And again, I can't even fully explain what the idea behind this move is, but Kasparov played it, and the computer likes it. So apparently this is okay. So we're gonna go with it. So a5, rook b8, and then d3, knight to d7, bishop e3. King h8, knight d2, knight e7, and then we had this mistake. We had bishop to c2 that happened in the game, and that allowed equality, and the game eventually did end in a draw. Now, what Kasparov should have played here was pawn to d4, and apparently after pawn to d4, white has some sort of major advantage here. After pawn to d4, we would have e captures d4, c captures d4, bishop to b4, rook fd1, and the computer gives this as major advantage white. A sample line would be something like c5, d takes c5, bishop c5, knight f1. The point being, of course, now we have this permanent weakness on d6, white has the better pieces, and white has more space. So the computer thinks this would have just been major advantage white, and this was certainly the direction that Kasparov should have gone. Going back, that's about the extent of the independent value of bishop c5. So now we're going to be taking a look at bishop b7, which is, of course, the mainline Archangel defense. So after bishop to b7, we should just play rook e1, and we should defend our pawn. It is also possible to play a much slower system here. You can play sort of almost an anti-martial-esque kind of move in this position. You can just play d3 and just play really slow chess. And this actually makes a lot of sense, because in a lot of cases when people play moves like bishop b7, they're trying to find an opportunity where they can play d5 and break in the middle, where maybe your pieces aren't set up for it, where maybe you've played c3 and h3 and you shouldn't have. In this case, when you play d3, you're basically making sure that you can cleanly develop your pieces, no matter what kind of development scheme black comes up with. And you can just play this very slow system. Like after bishop c5, you can play c3. After castles, you can play a4. This is what was played in Carlsen versus Georgiev in Oslo in Norway in 2014. And Carlsen did eventually go on to win. And so it's a totally reasonable way to play chess. It's kind of a slow, kind of grinding system. But it is certainly a reasonable way to play chess. So Carlsen has played this way himself with the white pieces. But I personally like the other direction. And one of the reasons I like this other direction with rook e1 is I do kind of want to stay away from the d5 possibility. In this other line, even in that particular game, Georgiev immediately played d5. And, you know, it feels like white's a little bit passive here. But like I said, you can play this. Carlsen did go on to win. But rook e1 I like a little bit better. We're going to have bishop to c5, and we're going to have c3. So this is much more of the traditional idea. And then we're going to have pawn to d6. It is also possible to have castles. D4, bishop b6, knight on bishop e2 is very similar to the other line, which is also supposed to be slight edge white. So d6, d4, bishop to b6, bishop e3, and castles. So it is good to note here that bishop e3 is the theoretical move, but it's also a decent enough move. Again, I know most of you are looking at your screen and screaming, like, why can't black just take this pawn on e4? And it's a good question. What happens if knight takes e4? Well, you lose material immediately. The move is d5, which attacks the knight on c6, and it also creates a discovered attack with bishop to b6 followed by rook takes e4. And there's no actual way to counter this. Like, if you play bishop takes e3, rook e3, that's also a double attack. We're threatening the knight on e4, and we're threatening the knight on c6. So, essentially, knight takes e4, d5 wins a piece. So, that's the short answer to why we can't play knight takes e4. So, instead, we're going to have castles kingside, and then we're going to have knight d2. Now, the game that I'm following is actually Anand versus Gadakomsky, played back in 1995. Anand versus Kamsky played back in 1995. And that game continued with pawn to h6, pawn to h3, queen to b8, and then we had pawn to d5. And this is kind of a maneuver that you see in a lot of different Ruy Lopezes, where white will push his pawn to d5, he'll have more space, and in this position especially, it makes a ton of sense. Because with the Archangel move order, with clumping all of your pieces over on the queen side, you're kind of cutting the board in half when you play a move like d5, and you're kind of making the statement that you're going to be going after this king side, and you're going to be trying to get play against the black king, and now all of these pieces are going to have to somehow find a way to transfer over to that king side, and it's not going to be terribly easy. So d5, knight e7, and now this is the idea, bishop b6, cb6, and now bishop to c2, and one of the ideas that white has here is white actually wants to prevent the move pawn to f5, because black is going to be trying to make that counter thrust to collapse white's center. And if he pulls it off, white's going to be in trouble. So that was the purpose behind Kamsky's next move, knight d7. He wants to play the move pawn to f5 and collapse the center. And of course, that's the reason that that Anand immediately plays knight to h4. He just has to stop pawn to f5. So we have knight to h4, then we have queen to d8, and then we have knight to f1, with the idea of bringing this knight to g3, and just further kind of shutting down this f5 push. So now here, Kamsky plays the move pawn to g5, trying to kick that knight away from covering f5, and then Anand, he says he spent 20 minutes finding the move knight to f3, making sure that he could reach the position that he reached about a few moves later, sort of by force. So knight f3 was played, and then Kamsky plays the move f5, which is the move Kamsky had been aiming for a while. And then we have e takes f5, knight takes f5, and then knight on 3 to h2. And now you can sort of start seeing Anand's idea. He wants to bring his pieces into the holes that have been created in black's camp, these light squared holes like e4 and g4. And he's going to be using these transfer points like e3 and g4 with his knight. And these light squares are going to be incredibly weak, and white should have some sort of advantage here. And as it turns out, white does have an advantage, and it was a pretty sizable one. So the game continued with queen to f6, knight to g4, queen to g7, knight on g to e3, going after those light squares, knight takes e3, knight takes e3, and then rook f4, and now a4, which again goes with the theme of going after these light squares. So we have a4, rook a to f8, a captures b5, a5, and then we have rook to f1 holding that f2 pawn, you know, which is in the short term the most important critical tactical thing. So bishop to c8, g3, kicking that rook off the f4 square, rook on 4 to f7, and then we have pawn to b4, basically just looking for an entry point for this rook so the rook can join the fun either on a7 or on a8. So we have b4, and then we have e4, just trying to get some counterplay. And then we have bishop takes e4, knight to e5, bishop back to g2, takes on b4, c takes b4, knight f3, bishop f3, rook f3, and now the rook comes and joins the party on the a8 square, and everything is looking pretty good. So now here things get a little wild, but the complications seem to just favor Anand. It continued with bishop takes h3. This allows queen takes f3, allowing this because of the pin. But of course, it's not as simple as that, because of course the rook on a8 is also hanging. So it's an exchange, but after the exchange takes place, white is the one with the initiative. White is the one with the extra pawn, black is the one with the weaker king. Even though at first glance it looks like maybe white's in some trouble too, white's really not. White's threatening to win this bishop in some cases with moves like g4. So it's actually black that's in the deep trouble here. White has the open file, white has the open spaces, and black's king is wide open. So white should have a winning advantage here. So here in this game we had rook f8, queen e2, bishop to d7, rook to c7. What's interesting is in a lot of places here, rook c6 is actually possible. Even right here, after rook f7, it's possible to just play rook c6. You can't actually capture the rook. Like, bishop takes rook, pawn takes is going to be a winning advantage for white. But he played, you know, just a little more correctly, maybe, rook b7. Although it's not, I mean, since rook c6 you can't take it, it's not clear that there's any actual difference between the moves. But anyways, so rook b7, queen a1, knight f1 got played. And then we have king g7, and then rook takes b6. And now Ananda's got some passed pawns to add to the fact that black's king is incredibly loose. And so at this point, it's just a matter of technique. We have queen to d4. We have rook to d8. Rook to b8. Queen takes b4. Knight to e3. h5. Pawn to b6, pushing that dangerous passed pawn. Pawn to h4. Pawn to g4. Bishop to b5. Queen to d1. Queen to b2, knight to f5 check, rook takes f5, g takes f5, bishop e2. So black is just, basically living on life support at this point. He's had to sacrifice an exchange, so he didn't get mated, and now he's playing an exchange down. White still has the initiative, and he's just pressing. So now, Anand says that he unnecessarily complicated matters, but the computer thinks Anand's move is fine. Anand preferred queen e1, and in fairness, the engine preferred it slightly as well. But both moves should be winning. Like, queen e1, h3, rook e8 is what Anand gave as being a lot simpler, and, I mean, the engine agrees. But queen a4 was equally fine. So queen a4, bishop to f3, then we have queen to d7 check, king h6, queen e6 check, king h5, and now we have this queen e8 check, king to g4, queen e1, you gotta do that to defend against mate. And this is probably what Anand was talking about. It's unnecessarily complicated to allow this counterplay possibility of queen b1 and queen h1 that you have to kind of babysit with a move like queen e1. So here we had bishop to d5, rook e8, and he's finally done the reorganization that maybe he should have done 7 moves ago. Bishop to f3, pawn to f6, and of course this is now game over because you can't stop both pawns. Anand actually made the comment, you can only run away from an avalanche, not stop it. So there's two pawns that are going to queen, and the queen can only take one of them at a time. So here we have king to h5, f7, queen to d4, rook to e4, and after queen to f6. And it's important to note that you can't take this rook with anything because we're queening and stuff. So it's kind of a cutesy move. You know, rook e4 prevents queen to g4 followed by queen to e2. So queen to g2. So if you prevent mate, you're essentially winning because you're creating this queen on the next move. So here we have queen to f6, pawn to b7, and both pawns are going to queen. So takes, queen takes, and then finally Gadakhmovsky resigns because, again, he can only take one pawn at a time, and the other one will make a queen, and that will be the end of the game. In conclusion, this is how we should be facing the Archangel defense. It's not actually a horribly complicated opening to face. After bishop to b7, rook e1, like I said, the majority of the players you play against are going to be playing bishop c5. Your main idea should just be to play c3 and to play d4. And take that position in the center of the board. And just as well, if they play this other move order, just beginning with bishop to c5, again, playing this c3 and d4 as quickly as possible is going to be your simplest way of meeting this Archangel defense. And white should expect to have some sort of advantage in all of these lines, whether that be a slight advantage, major advantage, or decisive advantage. You should have some sort of advantage here with white if you play c3 and d4 and strike in the middle as quickly as possible as soon as you see this bishop land on the c5 square. I hope you liked this video. I hope you found these ideas helpful, and I hope you can use some of these ideas in your own games. Thank you very much for watching.